Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Hitler's Hangman, The Life of Heydrich, by Robert Gerwarth, narrated by Napoleon Ryan. Preface. How does one write the biography of Reinhard Heydrich, one of the key players in the most murderous genocide of history, a historical figure the Nobel laureate Thomas Mann famously referred to as Hitler's Hangman? This is the question I have been asking myself from the moment I first decided to embark on this book project. It was always clear to me that the writing of a Nazi biography would pose a specific set of challenges, ranging from the need to master the vast and ever-growing body of literature on Hitler's dictatorship, to the peculiar problem of having to penetrate so the mind of a person whose mentality and ideological universe seem repellent and strangely distant, even though the Nazi dictatorship ended less than 70 years ago. But the major challenge lay elsewhere, namely in the fact that any kind of life writing requires a certain degree of empathy with the book's subject, even if that subject is Reinhard Heydrich. Biographers often use the contrasting images of autopsy and portrait to describe their work. While the autopsy offers a detached, forensic examination of a life, the portrait relies on the biographer's empathy with his subject. I have chosen to combine both of these approaches in a third way best described as cold empathy, an attempt to reconstruct Heydrich's life with critical distance, but without reading history backwards or succumbing to the danger of confusing the role of the historian with that of a state prosecutor at a war criminal's trial. Since historians ought to be primarily in the business of explanation and contextualization, not condemnation, I have tried to avoid the sensationalism and judgmental tone that tend to characterize earlier accounts of Heydrich's life. Heydrich's actions, language, and behavior speak for themselves, and wherever possible, I have tried to give space to his own characteristic voice and choice of expressions. Personal records, however, are scarce in Heydrich's case. I have searched the relevant archives in Germany, Britain, the United States, Russia, Israel, and the Czech Republic, and that search has revealed many more sources on Heydrich's life than are often assumed to exist. Yet unlike Joseph Goebbels or the young Heinrich Himmler, Heydrich did not keep a personal diary, and only fragments of his private correspondence have survived the Second World War. However, there exists a remarkably large body of official documents, speeches, and letters which allow us to reconstruct his daily routines and decision-making processes in great detail. In identifying the widely dispersed source material on which this book is based, I frequently had to rely on the helpful advice of archivists and librarians. I am very grateful for the expert assistance of the staff of several archives and libraries across the globe that have given me access to their extensive holdings and supplied me with unpublished material. These include the Institut für Zeitgeschichte in Munich, the German Federal Archives and its various branches in Berlin, Koblenz, Freiburg, and Ludwigsburg, the British and Czech National Archives in Kew and Prague, the archives of Yad Vashem in Jerusalem, and the Holocaust Memorial Museum in Washington, D.C., as well as the German Historical Institute in Moscow, which greatly facilitated my access to the Reich Security Main Office files in the Ozobie Archive. This book originated in Oxford, and I remain deeply indebted to many friends and former colleagues there. Martin Conway and Nicholas Stargardt advised on this project at various stages and provided most welcome criticism on earlier drafts of the book. Roy Foster taught me a great deal about life writing, has offered brilliant comments on the manuscript, and has remained a friend and inspiration beyond my time in Oxford. Since leaving Oxford in 2007, I have become a staff member of University College Dublin, which has given me remarkable freedom to research and to write. Among my colleagues at UCD, William Mulligan, Stefan Malinowski, and Harry White have been most helpful critical readers and sources of encouragement. Apart from my colleagues at UCD's Center for War Studies, I must also thank John Horn of Trinity College Dublin for 3 years of happy research collaboration and for being a constant inspiration in his dedication to historical scholarship. Outside Oxford and Dublin, Nikolaus Waxman, Chad Bryant, Mark Cornwall, and Jochen Böhler generously agreed to read drafts of my work, as did two anonymous readers who went far beyond the call of duty in commenting on my original ideas. Their suggestions have greatly enhanced the final manuscript, and I am immensely grateful to them. In Prague, I was fortunate to work with Miloš Hoej, whose ability to translate key sections of relevant Czech literature and sources has allowed me to incorporate the important work on the Nazi occupation of Bohemia and Moravia that has been published in Czech over the past 2 decades. In Berlin, I had the pleasure of working with Jan Bockelmann, whose diligence in compiling vast quantities of German sources and literature has greatly aided the timely completion of this study. He and Wolf Beck also did an expert job in providing the 2 maps in this volume, while Seamus Spark helped with the index. Heather McCallum commissioned this book some 6 years ago, and she and her colleagues at Yale University Press accompanied the production process with great enthusiasm, competence, and patience. It is difficult to imagine a better publisher. My final thanks, as always, go to my family. During my regular archival trips to Berlin, my parents, Michael and Evelyn Gerwarth, provided unfailing support, love, and encouragement, for which I cannot thank them enough. Finally, my debts to my wife Portia are enormous. She has read the manuscript from start to finish and had to live with my periodic absences and constant distraction over the past 5 years. Dedicating this book to her is a necessarily inadequate attempt to acknowledge the depth of my love and gratitude. Dublin, May 2011. Introduction. Reinhard Heydrich is widely recognized as one of the great iconic villains of the 20th century, an appalling figure even within the context of the Nazi elite. Countless TV documentaries, spurred on by the fascination with evil, have offered popular takes on his intriguing life, and there is no shortage of sensationalist accounts of his 1942 assassination and the unprecedented wave of retaliatory Nazi violence that culminated in the vengeful destruction of the Bohemian village of Lidice. Arguably the most spectacular secret service operation of the entire Second World War, the history of Operation Anthropoid and its violent aftermath has inspired the popular imagination ever since 1942, providing the backdrop to Heinrich Mann's Lidice, 1942, Bertolt Brecht's Hangmen Also Die, 1943, and Laurent Binet's recent Prix Goncourt-winning novel, HHHH, 2010. The continuing popular fascination with Heydrich is easily explained. Although merely 38 years old at the time of his violent death in Prague in June 1942, he had accumulated 3 key positions in Hitler's rapidly expanding empire. As head of the Nazis' vast political and criminal police apparatus, which merged with the powerful SS intelligence service, the SD, into the Reich Security Main Office, RSHA, in 1939, Heydrich commanded a sizable shadow army of Gestapo and SD officers directly responsible for Nazi terror at home and in the occupied territories. As such, he was also in charge of the infamous SS mobile killing squads, the Einsatzgruppen, during the campaigns against Austria, Czechoslovakia, Poland, and the Soviet Union. Secondly, in September 1941, Heydrich was appointed by Hitler as acting Reich Protector of Bohemia and Moravia, a position that made him the undisputed ruler of the former Czech lands. The 8 months of his rule in Prague and the aftermath of his assassination are still remembered as the darkest time in modern Czech history. Thirdly, in 1941, Heydrich was instructed by the second most powerful man in Nazi Germany, Hermann Göring, to find and implement a total solution of the Jewish question in Europe, a solution which, by the summer of 1942, culminated in the indiscriminate and systematic murder of the Jews of Europe. With these 3 positions, Reinhard Heydrich undoubtedly played a central role in the complex power system of the Third Reich. Yet, despite his major share of responsibility for some of the worst atrocities committed in the name of Nazi Germany, and the continuing interest of both historians and the general public in Hitler's dictatorship, Heydrich remains a remarkably neglected and oddly nebulous figure in the extensive literature on the Third Reich. Although some 40,000 books have been published on the history of Nazi Germany, including several important studies on other high-ranking SS officers, such as Heinrich Himmler, Ernst Kaltenbrunner, Adolf Eichmann, and Werner Best, there is no serious scholarly biography that spans the entire life of this key figure within the Nazi terror apparatus. The only exception to this remarkable neglect is Shlomo Aronson's pioneering 1967 PhD thesis on Heydrich's role in the early history of the Gestapo and the SD, which unfortunately ends in 1936 when the SS took full control of the German police. Written in German and never translated into English, Aronson's research has left a mine of material on Heydrich's early life that no later historian in the field can ignore. But his study is not a biography, and was never intended to be one. Several journalists have attempted to fill the gap left by professional historians. Although not without merit, particularly in gathering post-war testimonies of Heydrich's former SS associates and childhood friends, these earlier Heydrich biographies reflect a by now largely obsolete understanding of Nazi leaders as either depraved criminals or perversely rational desk killers, an interpretation that built on the post-war testimonies of Nazi victims and former SS men alike. The Swiss League of Nations High Commissioner in Danzig between 1937 and 1939, Karl Jakob Burckhardt, who had met Heydrich in the summer of 1935 during an inspection tour of Nazi concentration camps, famously described him in his memoirs as the Third Reich's young evil god of death. Post-war recollections of former SS subordinates were similarly unflattering. His deputy of many years, Dr. Werner Best, characterized Heydrich as the most demonic personality in the Nazi leadership, driven by an inhumanity which took no account of those he mowed down. Himmler's personal adjutant, Karl Wolf, described Heydrich as devilish, while Walter Schellenberg, the youngest of the departmental heads in the Reich Security main office, remembered his former boss as a ragingly ambitious man with an incredibly acute perception of the moral, human, professional, and political weakness of others. His unusual intellect, Schellenberg insisted, was matched by the ever-watchful instincts of a predatory animal, who, in a pack of ferocious wolves, must always prove himself the strongest. Such post-war testimonies of former SS officers must be approached with caution. With Heydrich, Himmler, and Hitler dead, and the Third Reich in ruins, Best, Wolf, Schellenberg, and other senior SS men in Allied captivity were keen to whitewash their own responsibility and to prove that they had merely followed orders from superiors who were too powerful and scary to be disobeyed. Yet their characterizations of Heydrich stuck in the popular imagination, fueled by books such as Charles Whiten's 1962 biography, Heydrich, Hitler's Most Evil Henchman. Whiten perpetuated a powerful myth in explaining Heydrich's murderous zeal, the myth of his alleged Jewish family background, which originated in Heydrich's early youth, and, despite the best efforts of his family to refute it, continued to resurface both during and after the Third Reich. After 1945, it was cultivated by former SS officers such as Wilhelm Hertel, who maintained in his autobiographical book, The Secret Front, 1950, that Heydrich ordered his agents to remove the gravestone of his Jewish grandmother. Others jumped on the potentially lucrative bandwagon of exposing the chief organizer of the Holocaust as a Jew. Presumably to boost his book sales with sensational revelations about the SS leadership, Himmler's Finnish masseur, Felix Kirsten, maintained, in his highly unreliable memoirs, that both Himmler and Hitler had known about Heydrich's dark secret from the early 1930s onwards, but chose to use the highly talented but also very dangerous man for the dirtiest deeds of the regime. Whiten was not alone in falling for the myth of Heydrich's Jewish origins. In his preface to the Kirsten memoirs, Hugh Trevor Roper confirmed, with all the authority that I possess, that Heydrich was a Jew, a view supported by eminent German historians such as Karl Dietrich Brache and the Hitler biographer Joachim Fest. Fest's brief character sketch of Heydrich, characteristically brilliant in style but unconvincing in content, added fuel to the popular debate about Heydrich's allegedly split personality. Fest reiterated the rumors about Heydrich's Jewish family background and attributed his actions to a self-loathing anti-Semitism. As a schizophrenic maniac driven by self-hatred, Heydrich wanted to prove his worth and became a man like a whiplash, running the Nazi terror apparatus with luciferic coldness in order to achieve his ultimate goal of becoming Hitler's successor. Fest's characterization of Heydrich was called into question by the emergence of a second influential image of senior SS officers, which is captured in the iconic photograph of Adolf Eichmann in his glass booth in the Jerusalem District Court. Hannah Arendt's famous account of that trial and her dictum about the banality of evil shaped the public perception of SS men in the decades that followed. For many years, the bureaucratic technocrat of death, the perversely rational culprit behind a desk, became the dominant image of Nazi perpetrators. These perpetrators focused on their duties, accepted the administrative tasks assigned to them, and carried them out correctly and conscientiously, without feeling responsible for their outcomes. The mass murder of the Jews was now seen not so much as a throwback to barbarism, but as the zenith of modern bureaucracy and dehumanizing technology that found its ultimate expression in the anonymous killing factories of Auschwitz. Mass murder was represented as a sanitized process carried out by professional men, doctors and lawyers, demographers and agronomists, who acted on the basis of amoral but seemingly rational decisions derived from racial eugenics, geopolitical considerations, and economic planning. Such images strongly impacted on another popular Heydrich biography, first published in 1977, Gunther Deschner's The Pursuit of Total Power. Deschner, a former writer for the conservative daily Die Welt, rightly dismissed the pseudo-psychological demonizations of Witten and Fest. Instead, he followed the prevalent trend of the 1970s and 1980s in describing Heydrich as the archetype of a high-level technocrat primarily interested in efficiency, performance, and total power, for whom Nazi ideology was first and foremost a vehicle for careerism. Ideology, Deschner suggested, was something Heydrich was too intelligent to take seriously. If the popular perception of Heydrich as the Third Reich's cold-blooded administrator of death has remained largely unchallenged over the years, the basic tenets on which this image rests have been well and truly eroded in the last two decades. First, it is now clear that ideology played a key motivational role for senior SS officers, and that any attempt to dismiss them as pathologically disturbed outsiders is highly misleading. If anything, SS perpetrators tended to be more educated than their average German or Western European contemporaries. More often than not, they were socially mobile and ambitious young university graduates from perfectly intact family backgrounds, by no means part of a deranged minority of extremists from the criminal margins of society. Second, it is now generally accepted that the decision-making processes which led to the Holocaust developed through several stages of gradual radicalization. The idea that Heydrich consciously planned the Holocaust from the early 1930s onwards, as was still argued by his biographer, Eduard Karlitz, in the 1980s, is a position that is no longer tenable. Although central to the development of persecution policies in Nazi Germany, Heydrich was only one of a large variety of actors in Berlin and German-occupied Europe who pushed for more and more extreme measures of exclusion and, ultimately, mass murder. Nazi Germany was not a smoothly hierarchical dictatorship, but rather a polycratic jungle of competing party and state agencies over which Hitler presided erratically. The cumulative radicalization in certain policy areas emerged as a result of tensions and conflicts between powerful individuals and interest groups, who sought to please their Führer by anticipating his orders. Within this complex power structure, individuals contributed to Nazi policies of persecution and murder for a whole range of reasons, from ideological commitment and hyper-nationalism to careerism, greed, sadism, weakness, or, more realistically, a combination of more than one of these elements. For a biographer of Heydrich, the revisionist arguments of the past decades pose a whole series of difficult questions. If the Holocaust was not a smoothly unfolding, centralized genocide, and Heydrich and Himmler were not responsible for every aspect of the persecution and mass murder of the Jews, what exactly were they responsible for? If, as some historians quite rightly suggest, the Holocaust was merely a first step towards the bloody unweaving of Europe's complex ethnic makeup, what role did Heydrich play in the evolution and implementation of these plans? Even more fundamentally, how did he become Heydrich? The answers provided in this book revise some older assumptions about Heydrich's personal transition to Nazism and his contribution to some of the worst crimes committed in the name of the Third Reich. Born as he was in 1904 into a privileged Catholic family of professional musicians in the city of Halle, Heydrich's path to genocide was anything but straightforward. Not only was his life conditioned by several unforeseeable events that were often beyond his control, but his actions can be fully explained only by placing them in the wider context of the intellectual, political, cultural, and socio-economic conditions that shaped German history in the first half of the 20th century. Heydrich was both a typical and an atypical representative of his generation. He shared in many of the deep ruptures and traumatic experiences of the so-called war youth generation, namely the Great War and the turbulent post-war years of revolutionary turmoil, hyperinflation, and social decline, which he experienced as a teenager. Yet, while these experiences made him and many other Germans susceptible to radical nationalism, Heydrich refrained from political activism throughout the 1920s and was even ostracized by his fellow naval officers for not being nationalist enough. The great turning point of his early life came in spring 1931, when he was dismissed from military service as a result of a broken engagement promise and his subsequent arrogant behavior towards the military court of honor. His dismissal, at the height of the Great Depression, roughly coincided with his first meeting with his future wife, Lena von Osten, who was already a committed Nazi and who convinced him to apply for a staff position in Heinrich Himmler's small but elite SS. Until this moment, Heydrich's life might have taken a very different direction, and indeed, he initially possessed few obvious qualifications for his subsequent role as head of the Gestapo and the SD. Crucial for his future development were his experiences and personal encounters within the SS after 1931, and in particular, his close relationship with Heinrich Himmler. In other words, the most significant contributing factor to Heydrich's radicalization was his immersion in a political milieu of young and often highly educated men who thrived on violent notions of cleansing Germany from its supposed internal enemies, while simultaneously rejecting bourgeois norms of morality as weak, outdated, and inappropriate for securing Germany's national rebirth. Yet his immersion in this violent world of deeply committed political extremists does not in itself explain why Heydrich emerged as arguably the most radical figure within the Nazi leadership. At least one of the reasons for his subsequent radicalism, it will be argued, lies in his lack of early Nazi credentials. Heydrich's earlier life contained some shortcomings, most notably the persistent rumors about his Jewish ancestry that led to a humiliating party investigation in 1932, and his relatively late conversion to Nazism. To make up for these imperfections and impress his superior, Heinrich Himmler, Heydrich transformed himself into a model Nazi, adopting and further radicalizing key tenets of Himmler's worldview and SS ideals of manliness, sporting prowess, and military bearing. Heydrich even manipulated the story of his earlier life to shore up his Nazi credentials. He supposedly fought in right-wing militant Freikorps units after the Great War, but his involvement in post-1918 paramilitary activity was at best minimal. Nor do any records exist to prove that he was a member of the various anti-Semitic groups in Halle, to which he later claimed to have belonged. By the mid-1930s, Heydrich had successfully reinvented himself as one of the most radical proponents of Nazi ideology and its implementation through rigid and increasingly extensive policies of persecution. The realization of Hitler's utopian society, so he firmly believed, required the ruthless and violent exclusion of those elements deemed dangerous to German society, a task that could best be carried out by the SS as the executioner of Hitler's will. Only by cleansing German society of all that was alien, sick, and hostile could a new national community emerge, and the inevitable war against the Reich's arch-enemy, the Soviet Union, be won. The means of cleansing envisaged by Heydrich were to change dramatically between 1933 and 1942, partly in response to circumstances beyond his control, and partly as a result of the increasing Machbarkeitswahn, fantasies of omnipotence, that gripped many senior SS men, policy planners, and demographic engineers after the outbreak of the Second World War. The delusional idea that a unique historical opportunity had arisen to fight, once and for all, Germany's real or imagined enemies inside and outside the Reich. While the mass extermination of Jews seemed inconceivable, even to Heydrich before the outbreak of war in 1939, his views on the matter radicalized over the following 2.5 years. A combination of wartime brutalization, frustration over failed expulsion schemes, pressures from local German administrators in the occupied East, and an ideologically motivated determination to solve the Jewish problem led to a situation in which he perceived systematic mass murder to be both feasible and desirable. The solution of the Jewish question, for which Heydrich bore direct responsibility from the late 1930s, was, however, only part of a much broader wartime plan to recreate the entire ethnic makeup of Europe through a massive project of expelling, resettling, and murdering millions of people in Eastern Europe after the Wehrmacht's victory over the Soviet Union. As acting Reich Protector of Bohemia and Moravia, a position he held between 1941 and his violent death in June 1942, Heydrich underlined his fundamental commitment to these plans by initiating a uniquely ambitious program of racial classification and cultural imperialism in the Protectorate. Despite his drive for the Germanization of East Central Europe, Heydrich was fully aware that its complete realization had to wait until the Wehrmacht's victory over the Red Army. It was simply impossible, from a logistical point of view, to expel, resettle, and murder an estimated 30 million Slavic people in the conquered East, while simultaneously fighting a war against a numerically superior alliance of enemies on the battlefields. The destruction of Europe's Jews, a much smaller and more easily identifiable community, posed considerably fewer logistical problems. For Heydrich and Himmler, the swift implementation of the final solution also offered a major strategic advantage vis-a-vis rival agencies in the occupied territories. By documenting their reliability in carrying out Hitler's genocidal orders, they recommended themselves to the Führer as the natural agency to implement the even bigger post-war project of Germanization. Heydrich's life therefore offers a uniquely privileged, intimate, and organic perspective on some of the darkest aspects of Nazi rule, many of which are often artificially divided or treated separately in the highly specialized literature on the Third Reich. The rise of the SS and the emergence of the Nazi police state. The decision-making processes that led to the Holocaust. The interconnections between anti-Jewish and Germanization policies. And the different ways in which German occupation regimes operated across Nazi-controlled Europe. On a more personal level, it illustrates the historical circumstances under which young men from perfectly normal middle-class backgrounds can become political extremists determined to use ultra-violence to implement their dystopian fantasies of radically transforming the world. Chapter 1. Death in Prague. The 27th of May 1942 was a beautiful day. The morning dawned bright and auspicious over the Bohemian lands, occupied by Nazi Germany since 1939. After a long and exceptionally cold winter, spring had finally arrived. The trees were in full blossom and the cafes of Prague were buzzing with life. Some 20 kilometers north of the capital, in the leafy gardens of his vast neoclassical country estate, the undisputed ruler of the Czech lands and chief of the Nazi terror apparatus, Reinhard Heydrich, was playing with his two young sons, Klaus and Heider, while his wife Lena, heavily pregnant with their fourth child, was watching from the terrace, holding their infant daughter Zilke. Both privately and professionally, Heydrich had every reason to be content. At the age of only 38, and as the second most powerful man in the SS behind Heinrich Himmler, he had built a reputation as one of the most uncompromising executors of Hitler's dystopian fantasies for the future of the Reich and Nazi-occupied Europe. The solution of the Jewish question in Europe, with which Heydrich had been officially charged in January 1941, was making rapid progress. By the spring of 1942, the Germans and their Eastern European accomplices had murdered some 1.5 million Jews, predominantly through face-to-face shootings. Many more would die in the killing factories in former Poland, where construction work for stationary gassing facilities had begun the previous winter. Despite Germany's recent declaration of war on the United States, Heydrich's future looked bright. On the Eastern and North African fronts, the German army was rapidly advancing and about to deal a number of devastating blows against the Allies. Resistance activities, to be sure, had increased throughout Europe since the German invasion of the Soviet Union in the summer of 1941. But Heydrich had good reason to be confident that these challenges to Nazi rule would strengthen, rather than weaken, the influence of the SS on German occupation policies, where Heydrich was widely considered to be the rising star. Contrary to his usual habit of driving to work shortly after dawn, Heydrich left his country estate at around 10 o'clock that morning. His driver, Johannes Klein, a man in his early 30s, was waiting for him in the lobby, ready to take Heydrich to his office in Prague Castle. And from there, to the airport, where Heydrich's plane was to fly him to Berlin to report to Hitler on the future governance of the Protectorate and to make more general policy suggestions on the combating of resistance activities throughout occupied Europe. As usual, they traveled the short distance to Prague in a Mercedes convertible and without a police escort. As Klein and Heydrich commenced their journey, neither of the two men could know that some 15 minutes down the road, in the suburb of Leuven, three Czechoslovak agents from Britain were nervously waiting for them, their guns and grenades carefully concealed under civilian clothing. Secret plans to assassinate Reinhard Heydrich had emerged in London more than half a year earlier, in late September 1941. The origins of the plan have remained highly controversial to this day, and have given rise to all sorts of conspiracy theories, largely because the parties involved, the British Special Operations Executive, SOE, and the Czechoslovak government in exile under President Edvard Beneš, officially denied all responsibility for the assassination after 1945. Neither of them wanted to be accused of condoning political assassination as a means of warfare, particularly since it had always been clear that the Germans would respond to the killing of a prominent Nazi leader with the most brutal reprisals against the civilian population. The surviving documents on the assassination reveal that the plan to kill Heydrich was primarily born out of desperation. Ever since the fall of France in the summer of 1940, and the inglorious retreat of the British expeditionary forces from Dunkirk, the British authorities had been struggling to regain the military initiative. With no chance of being able to defeat the German army by themselves, the British hoped to incite popular unrest in the Nazi-occupied territories, thereby deflecting vital German military resources to a number of trouble spots. Hugh Dalton, the Minister of Economic Warfare, talked about creating subversive organizations behind enemy lines, while the War Office was emphatically calling for active efforts to combat the serious loss of confidence in the British Empire, which has arisen following our recent disasters. Neither Dalton nor anyone else in the British cabinet had a firm grasp of the immense difficulties and deterrents facing the underground organizations in Nazi-occupied Europe. Nor did they appreciate how complicated it was to conduct small-scale sabotage operations. The Czechs and Poles in exile in Putney and Kensington were more realistic. They were unwilling to jeopardize their existing intelligence networks at home by organizing ambitious mass uprisings that could only fail in the face of an overwhelming German military presence. However, even when measured against the generally low levels of resistance activity in early 1941, the Czechs were seen by the British to be particularly complacent. As Beneš's chief intelligence advisor, František Moravec, admitted after the war, in terms of resistance activities in the occupied territories, Czechoslovakia was always at the bottom of the list. President Beneš became very embarrassed by this fact. He told me that in his consultations with representatives of Allied countries, the subject of meaningful resistance to the enemy cropped up with humiliating insistence. The British and the Russians, hard-pressed on their own battlefields, kept pointing out to Beneš the urgent need for maximum effort from every country, including Czechoslovakia. The lack of Czech resistance to Nazi rule was increasingly damaging Beneš's diplomatic position and endangered his ultimate post-war objective of re-establishing Czechoslovakia along its pre-1938 borders. Beneš feared that a negotiated peace between Germany and Britain would leave the Bohemian lands permanently within the Nazi sphere of influence. After all, the British government had still not disavowed the Munich Agreement of 1938, which permitted Hitler to occupy Czechoslovakia's largely German-inhabited Sudetenland, and it consciously delayed any reconsideration of that decision to keep up the pressure on Beneš. On the 5th of September 1941, an increasingly impatient Beneš radioed the Central Leadership of Home Resistance, UVOD, in Prague. "It is essential to move from theoretical plans and preparations to deeds. In London and Moscow, we have been informed that the destruction, or at least a considerable reduction of the weapons industry, would have a profound impact on the Germans at this moment. Our entire position will appear in a permanently unfavorable light if we do not at least keep pace with the others." Responding to pressure from London, UVOD indeed maximized its sabotage activities and coordinated a successful boycott of the Nazi-controlled protectorate press between the 14th and the 21st of September. Only 1 week later, however, Beneš's initial enthusiasm turned into utter frustration when Hitler decided to replace his weak Reich protector in Prague, Konstantin von Neurath, with the infamous head of the Reich Security Main Office, Reinhard Heydrich. Following Heydrich's arrival in Prague in September 1941, the German authorities massively tightened their grip on Czech society. Communication between the protectorate and London temporarily ceased to exist, and the underground was paralyzed by a wave of Gestapo arrests. As his ambitious plans for widespread resistance began to collapse around him, Beneš found an equally beleaguered ally in the British Special Operations Executive, SOE. Launched in July 1940 and instructed by Winston Churchill himself to set Europe ablaze by backing popular uprisings against Nazi rule, SOE had enjoyed very limited success in the first year of its existence. As Hugh Dalton noted in his diary in December 1941, "Our last reports have been almost bare, long tales of what has not been done. I am particularly anxious for a successful operation or two." Just like Beneš, SOE was increasingly desperate to deliver some kind of success to justify its existence, particularly after its well-established rival, the Secret Intelligence Service, SIS, had demanded in August 1941 that sole responsibility for sabotage operations in enemy territory should be transferred back to SIS and its director, Sir Stuart Mingis. Perceiving the fledgling SOE as an amateurish upstart organization, Mingis and his senior staff were keen to rid themselves of the seemingly inefficient rival agency. Over the following weeks, Beneš's intelligence chief, František Moravec, and high-ranking SOE representatives met frequently to find a solution to their common problem. They coordinated plans to drop Czech agents trained in intelligence, communications, and sabotage into the Protectorate. But a combination of bad weather conditions and lack of communication with the resistance leaders on the ground prevented concerted action. Moreover, they began to realize that even the successful deployment of trained experts in sabotage would not be spectacular enough to appease their critics. And so they came up with a much more ambitious plan. Since Hitler himself was beyond their reach, they would attempt to assassinate the head of Nazi Germany's terror apparatus, Reinhard Heydrich. On the 3rd of October 1941, 2 days after a secret SOE dossier described Heydrich as probably the second most dangerous man in German-occupied Europe, after Hitler himself, a clandestine meeting took place in London between the head of SOE, Frank Nelson, and Moravetz, during which details of the mission were discussed. They agreed that SOE would provide the weapons and training for 2 or 3 of Moravetz's men to carry out a spectacular assassination, Heydrich, if possible. The assassination of Heydrich, codenamed Operation Anthropoid, would underline both SOE's capability to deal a severe blow against the Nazi security apparatus and the determination of the Czech resistance to stand up to their German oppressors. If Benesch would have been satisfied with any spectacular act of resistance, the SOE had its mind clearly set on Heydrich as the ideal target. For their information about the target of Operation Anthropoid, British military intelligence relied heavily on the book Inside the Gestapo, published in 1940 by the now exiled ex-Gestapo officer Hans-Jürgen Köhler, who described his former boss Heydrich as the all-powerful police executive of the Third Reich. Without him, Himmler would be but a senseless dummy. He is the man who moves everything, behind the scenes, yet with unchanging dexterity. He is the power behind the throne, pulling the strings and following his own dark aims. Heydrich is young and intelligent. In short, he is the brutal, despotic, and merciless master of the Nazi police, a go-getter whose hard certainty of aim knows no deviation. Although he is hot-blooded and impetuous himself, he remains soberly, coldly calculating in the background and knows that the power he coveted is already his. Cruelty and sudden rage are just as severely disciplined in his makeup as his untiring activity. Köhler's emphasis on Heydrich as the man directly responsible for immeasurable suffering, misery, and death was highlighted in the copy attached to Heydrich's SOE file. The assassination plan devised by SOE less than a week later was already very specific. It called for a direct attack on Heydrich at a time when he would be driving from his country estate to Prague Castle, ideally at a crossroads where the car would have to slow down. Brutal German reprisals, so the somewhat cynical calculation implied, would lead to a more general uprising of the Czech population against Nazi rule. Since Benesch himself was apprehensive of the possible repercussions in the Protectorate, and since the British government could not be seen as officially violating international norms of warfare by sponsoring acts of terrorism, even in a war against Nazi oppression, both sides felt the need to produce some form of cover story. It was quickly agreed that the assassination was to be portrayed by Allied propaganda as a spontaneous act of resistance, planned and carried out by the Czech underground at home, although the resistance in Prague itself was never informed about London's plan to murder Heydrich. As Christmas approached, 3 vital missions were awaiting transport into the Protectorate. Anthropoid, the team trained to kill Heydrich, as well as Silver A and Silver B, 2 radio transmitter groups assigned to re-establish the severed communication lines between London and the Czech Home Resistance. The 2 men selected to assassinate Heydrich were well prepared for their mission. Jan Kubisch, a 27-year-old former NCO from Moravia, had gained his first experiences in resistance activities against the Germans in the spring of 1939, when he had belonged to one of the small resistance groups that had sprung up spontaneously after the Nazi invasion. When the Gestapo tried to arrest him, he managed to escape to Poland, where he met the second future Heydrich assassin, Josef Gabczyk, a short, but powerfully built locksmith from Slovakia, who, like Kubish, had served as an NCO in the former Czech army before fleeing the country in despair over the Nazi occupation. Like many other penniless young refugees from Czechoslovakia, Gabčík and Kubish enlisted in the French Foreign Legion and fought briefly on the Western Front in the early summer of 1940 before being evacuated to Britain after the fall of France. There, in accordance with an inter-allied agreement, they were recruited into the Czech Brigade, the small military arm of Beneš's government in exile, numbering some 3,000 men. When SOE began its recruitment for secret operations in the Protectorate, Gabčík and Kubish volunteered. But they were kept in the dark about the purpose of their mission. Only after months of extensive training, first near Manchester, then in the sabotage training camp in Camas Darak in Invernessshire, and at the Villa Bellasis, a requisitioned country estate in the home counties near Dorking, were they informed that they had been chosen to kill the Reich Protector himself. Although proud to be selected for such an important task, both Gabčík and Kubish knew that they were highly unlikely to survive their mission. The journey to the Protectorate across Nazi-controlled continental Europe was extraordinarily dangerous in itself, and even if they arrived safely in Prague and completed their mission, there was no escape plan. The two agents would remain underground until they were either killed or captured, or until Prague was liberated from Nazi rule. Both chose to make their wills on the 28th of December 1941, the night their flight departed from Tangmere Aerodrome, a secret RAF base in Sussex. The heavily laden Halifax, carrying 9 parachutists and the crew, crossed the channel into the dark skies over Nazi-occupied France before continuing its journey over Germany. Repeated attacks by German anti-aircraft batteries and Luftwaffe night fighter planes interrupted the journey, but they finally arrived over the Protectorate of Bohemia and Moravia shortly after 2 a.m. Heavy snow on the ground made it impossible for the pilot to identify the designated dropping zones for the three teams. Although instructed to aim for Pilsen, where the parachutists were supposed to make contact with local members of the Czech resistance, the pilot accidentally dropped Gabčík and Kubish into a snowy field near the village of Nehvizdi, some 30 kilometers east of Prague. Their contact addresses were now useless. There were other problems too. Gabčík seriously injured his ankle during the landing, and he rightly suspected that their arrival had not gone unnoticed. Because of the lack of visibility, the Halifax had descended to an altitude of just over 150 meters before dropping off the parachutists, and the bomber's heavy motors had roused half the village inhabitants from their sleep. At least 2 villagers saw the parachutes float down to earth. According to all the rules of probability, the Gestapo would pick up their trail sooner or later. Luck, however, was on the parachutists' side that day. A local gamekeeper, sympathetic to the national cause, was the first to find them. After seeing their parachutes buried in the snow, he followed their footprints to an abandoned quarry. He was soon joined by the local miller of Nehvizdi, Bretislav Bauman, who happened to be a member of a Czech resistance group and who put them in touch with comrades in Prague. Bauman would pay dearly for helping the assassins. After Heydrich's death, he and his wife were arrested and sent to Mauthausen concentration camp, where they were murdered. Shortly after the new year, Gabčík and Kubish took the train to Prague, where they spent the next 5 months moving among various safe houses provided by UVOD. Their equipment, which included grenades, pistols, and a Sten gun, followed. In search of an ideal spot to carry out the assassination, they spent weeks walking or cycling around Prague Castle, Heydrich's country estate, and the road that Heydrich used to commute between the two. By early February, they had identified a seemingly ideal spot for an attack. A sharp hairpin curve in the Prague suburb of Lieben, where Heydrich passed by on his daily commute to work. The location seemed perfect, as Heydrich's car would have to slow down to walking pace at the hairpin bend, allowing Gabčík and Kubish to shoot their target from close quarters. There was also a bus stop just behind the bend, where the assassins could wait for Heydrich's car without arousing suspicion. Yet the apparent ease with which the parachutists had managed to infiltrate the protectorate made them less cautious than they should have been in the circumstances. Both Gapchik and Kubisch began sexual affairs with women they met through the families that offered them shelter, thus violating all rules of secrecy. Numerous persons and families who belonged to the wider Czech resistance circle were unnecessarily compromised by the careless use of safe houses and borrowed bicycles, articles of clothing, and briefcases that would subsequently lead the Gestapo to their helpers, and ultimately wipe out all organized resistance in the protectorate. For the time being, however, Gabchik and Kubisch were lucky enough not to be discovered. Others were less fortunate. The five parachutists of Groups Silver A and Silver B, who had been airdropped only minutes after Gabchik and Kubisch on the night of the 28th of December, split up shortly after landing. Many of them were either arrested by the Gestapo or turned themselves in when they felt that their families were endangered. Only the group leader of Silver A, Alfred Bartosz, managed to re-establish contact with one of the few surviving commanders of UVOD, Captain Václav Moravec, and to install a radio transmitter, codenamed Le Boucher, which soon began beaming information on industrial production and the population's mood back to London. His reports, however, confirmed that resistance activities in the Protectorate had become exceptionally difficult, if not impossible, because, for everyone politically active, there is a permanent Gestapo agent. If another of the reasons for sending agents into the Protectorate was to facilitate the bombing of vital arms production plants, this too had limited success. A plan to coordinate a British air raid on the Škoda works in Pilsen, with the aid of the Le Boucher transmitter, faltered. Other missions, including Silver B, failed completely. Between December 1941 and the end of May 1942, 16 other parachutists from England were dropped over the Protectorate, but none of them completed his mission. Two were arrested by police. Two placed themselves voluntarily at the Gestapo's disposal in order to avoid imprisonment or torture, and some were shot or committed suicide when chased by the German police. Others simply abandoned their missions and returned home to their families. Surprised by the pervasiveness of the Nazi police state and holding poor quality false documents, many simply panicked. In one case, a parachutist sent word to his mother that he was alive and well. The excited mother told an acquaintance, who promptly reported the news to the Gestapo. The parachutist's father and two brothers were held as hostages and threatened with execution until the parachutist turned himself in. In May, Bartosz demanded that the parachute drops be halted altogether. "You are sending us people for whom we have no use," he told London. "They are a burden on the organizational network, which is undesirable in today's critical times. The Czech and German security authorities have so much information and knowledge about us that to repeat these operations would be a waste of people and equipment." But SOE and Benesch pressed on. Before long, to his horror, Bartosz found out about the purpose of the mission entrusted to Gabchik and Kubisch. Twice in early May, UVOD broadcast desperate messages to Benesch entreating him to abandon the assassination, arguing that German reprisals for the killing of Heydrich were likely to wipe out whatever was left of the Czech underground. Judging by the preparations which Otter and Zdenek, the codenames of Gabchik and Kubisch, are making, and by the place where they are making these preparations, we assume, in spite of the silence they are maintaining, that they are planning to assassinate H. This assassination would in no way benefit the Allies, and might have incalculable consequences for our nation. It would not only endanger our hostages and political prisoners, but also cost thousands of other lives. It would expose the nation to unparalleled consequences, while at the same time sweeping away the last remnants of underground organization. As a result, it would become impossible to do anything useful for the Allies in future. We therefore ask that you issue instructions through Silver A for the assassination to be cancelled. Delay might prove dangerous. Send instructions immediately, Should an assassination nevertheless be desirable for considerations of foreign policy, let it be directed against someone else. 2 days later, Benesch's chief of intelligence, František Moravec, responded with a misleading message. Don't worry when it comes to terrorist actions. We believe we see the situation clearly. Therefore, given the situation, any actions against officials of the German Reich do not come into consideration. Let UVOD know. The following day, on the 15th of May, Benesch himself sent a message to the underground without even mentioning the assassination plan. I expect that in the forthcoming offensive, the Germans will push with their forces. They are sure to have some success. In such a case, I would expect German proposals for an inclusive peace. The crisis would be a serious one for us. In such a situation, an act of violence such as disturbances, direct subversion, sabotage, or demonstrations might be imperative or even necessary in our country. This would save the nation internationally, and even great sacrifices would be worth it. Benesch had once again succumbed to pressure from the British government. As intelligence analysts in London pointed out, recent telegrams from Silver A indicate that the Czech people are relying more and more on the Russians, a development that posed a serious threat to British long-term interests in Central Europe. The democratic Czech underground, the report concluded, was simply not pulling its weight and was surely capable of making far greater efforts. It now appeared essential both from the military and political point of view to take drastic action to revive confidence in the British war effort, and particularly in SOE, if we are to maintain the initiative in directing subsequent operations. Gabčík and Kubiš, despite final pleas from their underground protectors to abandon the mission, decided that it was time to act. As soldiers, they felt that they were in no position to question orders that had been given to them directly by Benesch. When a Czech informer from within Prague Castle leaked to the resistance Heydrich's travel plans for a meeting with Hitler on the 27th of May, suggesting that the Reich protector would then be out of the country for several weeks, Gabčík and Kubiš decided that this was the date on which to carry out the assassination. On the morning of the 27th of May, while Heydrich was still playing with his children in his country estate, they accordingly positioned themselves near the hairpin curve designated for the attack. Despite the warm weather, Gabčík carried a raincoat over his arm, concealing his submachine gun. On the opposite side of the street, Kubiš was leaning against a lamppost, two highly sensitive fused bombs in his briefcase. A third man, Josef Valčík, who had been parachuted into the protectorate in December as a member of Team Silver A, positioned himself further up the hill where he acted as lookout for the approaching car. At around 10:20 a.m., Valčík's shaving mirror flashed in the sun, signaling that Heydrich's car was approaching. As the assassins had anticipated, Heydrich's driver slowed down for the bend. When the car turned the corner, Gabčík leaped out, aiming his machine gun at Heydrich and pulling the trigger. But the gun, previously dismantled and concealed in his briefcase under a layer of grass, jammed. Heydrich, assuming that there was only one assassin, hastily ordered his driver to stop the car and drew his pistol, determined to shoot Gabčík. A fatal error of judgment that would cost him his life. As the car braked sharply, Kubiš stepped out of the shadows and tossed one of his bombs towards the open Mercedes. He misjudged the distance, and the bomb exploded against the car's rear wheel, throwing shrapnel back into Kubiš's face and shattering the windows of a passing tram. As the noise of the explosion died away, Heydrich and his driver jumped from the wrecked car with drawn pistols ready to kill the assassins. While Klein ran towards Kubiš, who was half-blinded by blood dripping from his forehead, Heydrich turned uphill to where Gabčík stood, still paralyzed and holding his useless machine gun. As Klein stumbled towards him, disorientated by the explosion, Kubiš managed to grab his bicycle and escape downhill, convinced that the assassination attempt had failed. Gabčík found escape less easy. As Heydrich came towards him through the dust of the explosion, Gabčík took cover behind a telegraph pole, fully expecting Heydrich to shoot him. Suddenly, however, Heydrich collapsed in agony, while Gabczyk seized his opportunity and fled. As soon as the assassins had vanished, Czech and German passers-by came to Heydrich's aid and halted a baker's van, which transported the injured man to the nearby Bulovka hospital, where an X-ray confirmed that surgery was urgently required. His diaphragm was ruptured, and fragments of shrapnel and horsehair from the car's upholstery were lodged in his spleen. Although in severe pain, Heydrich's paranoia and suspicion of the Czechs were strong. He refused to let the local doctor operate on him, demanding instead that a specialist be flown in from Berlin to perform the urgently needed surgery. By noon, he settled for a compromise and agreed that a team of local specialists, led by Professor Josef A. Holbaum from the German Surgical Clinic of Prague, should carry out the operation. Shortly after midday, Heydrich was wheeled into the operating theater, while Himmler and Hitler, who had been immediately informed of the attack, dispatched their personal physicians, Professor Karl Gebhardt and Dr. Theodor Morell, to Prague. While Heydrich lay in hospital, his fate uncertain, rage spread among Nazi leaders and protectorate Germans. Police had to restrain ethnic Germans from attacking Czech stores, bars, and restaurants, and from lynching their Czech neighbors. Officially, the Nazi-controlled press played down the significance of the attack, emphasizing that Heydrich's injuries were not life-threatening, and instead reporting on the successes of the German summer offensive on the Eastern Front. Most notably, the recent encirclement battle south of Kharkov, where more than 240,000 Red Army soldiers had been taken prisoner. Privately, however, the Nazi leadership was far more agitated than it was willing to admit in public. As Goebbels noted in his diary on the 28th of May 1942, "Alarming news is arriving from Prague. A bomb attack was staged against Heydrich in a Prague suburb, which has severely wounded him. Even if he is not in mortal danger at the moment, his condition is nevertheless worrisome. It is imperative that we get hold of the assassins. Then a tribunal should be held to deal with them and their accomplices. The background of the attack is not yet clear, but it is revealing that London reported on the attack very early on. We must be clear that such an attack could set a precedent if we do not counter it with the most brutal of means." The Führer himself was entirely in agreement. Less than an hour after the assassination attempt, an outraged Hitler ordered Heydrich's deputy and higher SS and police leader in the Protectorate, Karl Hermann Frank, to execute up to 10,000 Czechs in retaliation for the attack. Later that evening, a deeply shaken Himmler reiterated Hitler's order, insisting that the 100 most important Czech hostages should be shot that very night. Frank, fearing that large-scale reprisals might work against Germany's vital economic interests in the region, immediately flew to Berlin in a bid to convince Hitler that the attack was an isolated act orchestrated from London. To engage in mass killings, Frank suggested, would mean to abandon Heydrich's successful occupation policies, endangering the productivity of the Czech armaments industry and playing into the hands of enemy propaganda. Hitler, however, was furious and threatened to send SS General Erich von dem Bach-Zelewski, head of SS anti-partisan warfare on the Eastern Front, to Prague. Bach-Zelewski, Hitler insisted, would happily wade through a sea of blood without the least scruple. The Czechs have to learn the lesson that if they shoot down one man, he will immediately be replaced by somebody even worse. By the end of the meeting, however, Frank had managed to talk Hitler down. For the time being, the Führer rescinded his order for the indiscriminate killings of 10,000 hostages, but insisted that the assassins had to be captured immediately. Before his departure from Prague, Frank had imposed martial law over the Protectorate. Anyone providing help or shelter for the assassins, or even failing to report information on their whereabouts to the police, was to be killed along with their entire families. The same fate awaited those Czechs over 16 years of age who failed to obtain new identification papers before midnight of Friday, the 29th of May. Anyone found without proper papers on Saturday was to be shot. Railway services and all other means of public transportation ceased. Cinemas and theaters, Restaurants and coffee houses were closed. The Prague Music Festival was interrupted. A curfew was established from 9 p.m. to 6 a.m., and in accordance with Hitler's directive, a reward of 10 million crowns for the capture of the assassins was announced. The Protectorate government, keen to distance itself from the assassination, pledged to double the reward. Over the course of the afternoon, the head of the German Order Police, Kurt Dalug, was ordered by telephone to assume the post of acting Reich Protector and to hunt down the assassins with all means at his disposal. Fearing that the assassination attempt might be the signal for a more general uprising in the Protectorate, Dalug immediately unleashed one of the largest police operations in modern European history. Prague was completely sealed off by the German police and army. Gestapo units, reinforced by contingents from the Order Police, the SS, the Czech Gendarmerie, and three Wehrmacht battalions, more than 12,000 men in total, began to raid some 36,000 buildings in search of the assassins. Yet although scarcely a single house was left unexamined, the police operation failed to deliver the desired results. Around 500 people were arrested for minor offenses unrelated to the assassination attempt. But despite a vast number of hints and false allegations provided by the Czech and German population, the perpetrators were not apprehended. While the civilian population in the Protectorate was holding its breath in fear of reprisals, Benesch was ecstatic, even though the outcome of the assassination attempt remained uncertain. He immediately sent out a radio message to Bartosz, their principal contact on the ground. "I see that you and your friends are full of determination. It is proof to me that the entire Czech nation is unshakable in its position. I assure you that it is bringing results. The events at home have had an incredible effect in London and have brought great recognition of the Czech nation's resistance." Yet it was far from certain at this stage that Heydrich would succumb to his injuries. On the 31st of May, Himmler visited him in his hospital room in Prague. The wounded man's condition improved steadily, and they were able to have a brief conversation. 2 days later, however, an infection in the stomach cavity set in. Had penicillin been available in Germany in 1942, Heydrich would have survived. Without it, his fever got worse and he slipped into a coma, giving rise to renewed fears in Berlin that he might die. On the 2nd of June, Goebbels reflected on Heydrich's worsening condition in his diary and added, "The loss of Heydrich would be disastrous." A similar view prevailed in Britain. If Heydrich should not survive the attempt, or if he is invalided for some appreciable time, the loss for the Nazi regime would be very serious indeed. It can safely be said that next to Himmler, Heydrich is the soul of the terror machinery. The loss of the mastermind will have serious consequences. On the 3rd of June, Heydrich's condition deteriorated further. The doctors were unable to combat his septicemia. His temperature soared, and he was in great pain. The following morning, at 9 o'clock, Heydrich succumbed to his blood infection. Hitler's hangman, as Thomas Mann famously called him in his BBC commentary the following day, was dead. Chapter 2. Young Reinhard. The Heydrich Family. Reinhard Tristan Eugen Heydrich was born on the 7th of March 1904 in the Prussian city of Halle on the River Saale. His names reflected the musical background and interests of his family. His father, Bruno Heydrich, was a composer and opera singer of some distinction, who had earned nationwide recognition as the founding director of the Halle Conservatory, where his wife, Elisabeth, worked as a piano instructor. In naming their firstborn son, they took inspiration from the world of music that surrounded them. Reinhard was the name of the tragic hero of Bruno's first opera, Amen, which had premiered in 1895. Tristan paid tribute to Richard Wagner's opera Tristan and Isolde, and Eugen was the name of his late maternal grandfather, Professor Eugen Krantz, the director of one of Germany's most acclaimed musical academies, the Royal Dresden Conservatory. Reinhard's birth coincided with a period of rapid change and boundless optimism in Germany. Under Bismarck and Wilhelm II, Imperial Germany had become the powerhouse of Europe. Its economic and military might was preeminent, and its science, technology, education, and municipal administration were the envy of the world. But the modernity associated with Wilhelmine Germany also had its darker sides, notably a widespread yearning to become a world power whose influence could match its economic and cultural achievements. Imperial Germany, the country of Heydrich's birth, is therefore best described as Janus-faced. Politically semi-authoritarian, with a leadership prepared to enhance the country's international standing through reckless foreign policy adventures, but culturally and scientifically hyper-modern. Reinhard's father, Bruno Heydrich, was a beneficiary of the almost uninterrupted economic boom that had fundamentally transformed Germany since 1871, the time at which the German nation-state had emerged from a diverse collection of kingdoms, grand duchies, principalities, and free cities in Central Europe after three victorious wars against Denmark, 1864, Austria, 1866, and France, 1870-71. Born in February 1863 into a Protestant working-class family in the Saxon village of Leuben, Bruno experienced austerity and economic hardship in early life. The path of his parents, Ernestina Wilhelmina and Karl Julius Reinhold Heydrich, led from Leuben, where Karl worked as an impoverished apprentice cabinet maker, to the city of Meissen, internationally renowned for its porcelain manufactory, where the family resided from 1867 onwards. Upon his early death from tuberculosis in May 1874, at the age of just 37, Karl Julius left behind three sons and three daughters aged between 3 and 13. Karl Heydrich's early death left his family in an economically desolate situation. With no inheritance to speak of, Bruno's mother was forced to accept odd jobs to earn a living for herself and her six children. Bruno Heydrich later recalled a difficult, sorrowful youth, during which he was compelled to play the dual role of breadwinner and educator for his younger siblings, particularly after his elder brother, Reinhold Otto, died of consumption at the age of 19. Finding it hard to feed her children, Ernestina Heydrich searched for a new provider, and in May 1877, she married a Protestant locksmith, Gustav Robert Zuss, who was 13 years her junior and just 9 years older than her eldest son, Bruno. In subsequent years, it was Zuss's Jewish-sounding family name that would fuel speculation about Heydrich's non-Aryan ancestry, even though Zuss himself was neither Bruno's father nor of Jewish descent. Given his modest family background, Bruno's decision to embark on the career of a professional musician was unusual and required considerable talent and motivation. The professional musician, trained specifically to perform in concert halls and operas, was a relatively recent phenomenon in Germany. The first full-fledged music conservatory in Germany, Felix Mendelssohn's establishment in Leipzig, dated back only to 1843, and the Berlin Philharmonic, soon the epitome of the serious music ensemble, was founded in 1882. A musical education was also costly, and Bruno's mother had no money to spare. But Bruno was not easily deterred. At the age of 12, while still at school in Meissen, he began to play first the violin and the tenor horn, and then the double bass and tuba. The hobby soon turned into a much-needed source of revenue, as he and his younger brother Richard supplemented the family income by singing at local fairs. Bruno's gift as a singer did not go unnoticed, and by the age of 13, he was already performing as a soloist in public concerts with the Meissen Youth Orchestra. Bruno's talent and determination led to recognition from beyond the small Meissen community. In April 1879, he won a scholarship for a 3-year degree in composition and singing at the prestigious Royal Dresden Conservatory, Saxony's finest establishment for musical education, which was directed by his future father-in-law, the royal counselor, Professor Eugen Krantz. In July 1882, Bruno graduated from the Dresden Conservatory with the highest honors and began to play the contrabass in the Meiningen and Dresden court orchestras. Guest performances as Lionel in Friedrich von Flotow's comic opera Martha at the Court Theatre in Sondershausen, 1887, and in the title roles in Lohengrin in Weimar, 1889, and Tannhäuser and Faust in Magdeburg, 1890, were followed by engagements as a heroic tenor in Stettin, Kolberg, Aachen, Cologne, Halle, and Frankfurt, and then on the international stages of Antwerp, Geneva, Brussels, Vienna, Prague, and Marienbad. Heydrich's success was considerable, but not sufficient to sustain a viable career as a professional tenor, particularly since he continued to support financially his mother and her four daughters, one of whom was the product of her second marriage. Even so, his early success secured him an invitation to Bayreuth, where, in the summer of 1890, he sang excerpts from Lohengrin, Parsifal, Die Meistersinger, and Rienzi for Richard Wagner's widow, Cosima. In Wagner's Festival Theatre, built in 1871 on the green hills just outside the small Franconian town of Bayreuth, Heydrich might have had the major breakthrough of his career. But his dream of an engagement at the Bayreuth Wagner Festival was not to be. He was never asked back. Bruno Heydrich's failure to secure employment in Bayreuth has contributed to the misleading post-war assessment that he was a second or third class musician, an assessment that has been unduly influenced by his son's criminal career in the Third Reich. The head conductor of the New York Philharmonic Orchestra, Bruno Walter, who met Bruno Heydrich in Cologne in the mid-1890s, and who, as a German Jew, had been forced into exile by the Nazis in 1933, stated after the war that Reinhard's father had a charmless, no longer entirely fresh voice, and that he was regarded as a questionable character among colleagues. The Nazi executioner Reinhard Heydrich, Walter added, was the appalling son of this man, and when I read about that sadist, I often think of the mediocre singer with the ugly voice, who was chosen by fate to sire a devil. Walter's post-war assessment, clouded by Reinhard Heydrich's crimes in the Third Reich, stands in stark contrast to contemporary estimations of Bruno's talents, which suggest that he enjoyed high prestige among his peers. In the words of one music critic, Otto Reitzel, Bruno Heydrich's appearance as Siegfried at the Cologne City Theatre in 1896 was distinguished by musical infallibility, while another critic praised his performance as Fra Diavolo in Brunswick in 1901 as an utterly perfect impersonation. Success bred success, and in 1895, the same year that he met Bruno Walter, Heydrich was offered the lead role in Hans Pfitzner's Der arme Heinrich in Mainz. Pfitzner had become acquainted with Heydrich in Cologne and was so impressed by his musically and intellectually alert performance as Siegfried that he offered him the lead role in his new opera. Alongside his professional activities as an opera singer, Bruno increasingly devoted himself to composition, ultimately writing no fewer than five operas. Amen, 1895. Frieden, Peace, 1907. Zufall, Chance, 1914. Das Leiermädchen, The Lyre Child, 1921. And Das ewige Licht, The Eternal Light, 1923. Bruno's works were not among the finest compositions of the late 19th and early 20th century, but the staging of several operas in the homeland of classical music, alongside the works of composers like Beethoven, Mendelssohn, Wagner, and Strauss, signified considerable success in itself. In terms of style and content, his compositions were inspired by the towering example of Richard Wagner, the leading avant-garde artist of his time, whose four-part music drama The Ring of the Nibelung, 1876, had revolutionized the international opera scene, taking musical romanticism to new and potentially insurmountable heights. The major themes of Wagner's compositions, love, power, and the eternal clashes between good and evil, which he developed most powerfully in his last musical dramas, Tristan, Die Meistersinger, and Parsifal, deeply impacted on Bruno Heydrich's own work, as became evident when his first opera, Amen, premiered in Cologne in September 1895 to great critical acclaim. Like Wagner's heroes, Siegfried and Tristan, the protagonist of Amen, Reinhard, is an ultimately tragic figure tested by fate and by the devious deeds of the opera's villain, the peasant leader Thomas, representing the threatening rise of social democracy in Imperial Germany. In contrast to Thomas, the crippled villain who kills Reinhard through a callous stab in the back, Reinhard is a Germanic hero figure equipped with great moral, intellectual, and physical gifts, sufficiently so for Bruno to name his eldest son after him. The opera's success brought national recognition and a certain degree of material security, allowing Bruno to marry the daughter of his mentor, Professor Kranz, in December 1897. Reinhard Heydrich's mother, Elisabeth Anna Amalia Kranz, was 26 at the time of the wedding, and, in many ways, the extreme opposite of her husband. An imposingly tall and slightly overweight figure with black curly hair, Bruno was jovial and entertaining, punctuating his speech with wild theatrical gestures, whereas Elisabeth was small and of slight build, her bearing strict and well-disciplined. Moreover, Elisabeth was raised as a Catholic and was therefore a member of a religious minority. Catholics accounted for 36% of the empire's population, and interconfessional marriages were rare. Elisabeth's mother, Maria Antonia, herself the daughter of a wealthy business family in Bautzen, had brought her children up fully cognizant of their social status as a wealthy upper-middle-class family. Her two sons were sent to London to train as merchants and acquire foreign language skills, while Elisabeth was educated in a Catholic convent in Lugano before training as a pianist in her father's conservatory. Such an upbringing was common for the daughters of wealthy families. In order to support the social aspirations of their husbands, especially in the educated middle classes, wives were increasingly expected to have a well-rounded education, artistic talent, and musical abilities. Despite the couple's different upbringings and characters, the Heydrich marriage was a love match. They shared a deep passion for music, and their mutual affection was strong enough to overcome the considerable differences in social status, wealth, and religious upbringing. Encouraged by the success of Amen, Bruno Heydrich harbored ambitious plans for his second opera, Frieden, which he wanted to be staged at the Berlin Court Opera as a sign of royal endorsement. Official distinctions and royal patronage mattered a great deal in Imperial Germany, but Bruno's high-flying plans came to nothing. Instead, Frieden premiered in Mainz on the 27th of January 1907 to honor the 48th birthday of Kaiser Wilhelm II. The Kaiser's lack of interest in Bruno's opera was partly due to its content. Set in the 16th century, the three-act opera had a strongly religious subtext and revolved around Catholic notions of sin and redemption, not exactly a draw card for the head of the German Protestant Church. The mixed public reception of Frieden was a disappointment for Heydrich, and his stage appearances became less frequent. But although a major breakthrough as a composer was to elude him, he left behind an extensive oeuvre, including five operas, several piano compositions, choral works, lyrical triplets, and chamber music pieces, 60 compositions altogether by the outbreak of the Great War, securing him a more than negligible place in the history of early 20th century German music. Bruno's greatest success, however, was as a teacher of music. After his marriage into the Kranz family, and aided by the substantial inheritance left to Elisabeth by her father upon his early death in 1898, the Heydrichs moved to the city of Halle, the birthplace of Georg Friedrich Händel, where Bruno founded the Halle Choir School, an institution based on the famous model of Karl Friedrich Christian Fasch's internationally acclaimed Prussian Sing Academy. Although long established as one of Germany's finest university towns, and home to internationally renowned academics such as the economist Gustav Schmoller, 1845 to 1917, and the Leopoldina, Germany's oldest academy for science, Halle had been a sleepy, medium-sized provincial town with no more than 50,000 inhabitants for most of the 19th century. By the time the Heydrichs arrived, however, it had become one of Germany's booming cities, whose prosperity was based on a rapidly expanding mining and chemical industry, as well as a growing number of regional banks that transformed Halle into the sixth largest German city with a population of 156,000. Of the many beneficiaries of this radical transformation process, the middle classes prospered most. With their growing wealth, the social status attached to a distinct bourgeois culture of Bildung, education and cultivation through engagement with literature, music, and the fine arts, increased. For all the backwardness of its political elite, Imperial Germany was a country with a hyper-modern cultural scene, a country in which these arts were widely cherished and officially promoted. By the time Bruno Heydrich opened his business in Halle, music had become a middle-class commodity which formed an essential part of a bourgeois education. Its representative medium was the piano, which became an affordable asset of many middle-class living rooms in the late 19th century. With the shift in piano manufacture from craft shop to factory by the mid-19th century, the production of pianos increased eightfold in Germany between 1870 and 1910. Their cost was accordingly cut by half, and the piano became the centerpiece of middle-class cultivation. Hausmusik, or simple compositions for amateur players, was a central feature of middle-class entertainment and culture. In 1901, Bruno Heydrich's small choir school became a fully-fledged conservatory, specializing in piano and singing lessons. It was the first establishment of its kind in Halle. Progress was swift in the following years. The citizens of the increasingly wealthy and fast-growing city were well able to afford to send their children to the conservatory. Several times a year, Bruno's pupils staged public concerts, which soon became an important feature of Halle's cultural life. Parallel to his professional success, Bruno Heydrich managed to integrate himself fully into Halle's social circles. As in other European cities at the time, clubs and associations in Halle remained the preferred framework for middle-class social interactions. The Halle Registry of 1900 listed 436 private clubs and associations, many of them learned societies that catered for the interests of the university-educated and wealthy middle classes, and arranged literature evenings, concerts, balls, and similarly edifying social events. One of the most socially influential of these organizations was the Freemason Lodge of the Three Sabres, whose membership included both university staff and members of the wider business community. It is unclear when Bruno Heydrich joined the lodge, but he repeatedly organized concerts on its premises in the first years of the 20th century. Bruno was also one of the founders of the Halle branch of the Schlaraffia Society, an all-male organization founded in Prague in 1859 with the purpose of advancing the arts, conviviality, and friendship across national borders. Membership of the Schlaraffia was not atypical for an artist like Bruno Heydrich. More eminent contemporaries such as the famous Hungarian composer Franz Lehár and the Austrian poet Peter Rosiger were members of the society, which operated across Central Europe. As a local celebrity, Bruno was also made an honorary member of several of the town's musical societies, such as the Hallischer Liedertafel, a men's choir founded in 1834. At the Liedertafel's 75th anniversary in 1909, he composed a hymn to the men's choir and repeatedly staged choral performances involving both members of the Liedertafel and students from his conservatory. Meanwhile, the Halle Conservatory continued to thrive. The number of students grew rapidly, from 20 in 1902 to 190 in 1904, requiring 11 permanent teachers, 4 teaching assistants, and a secretary. At this point, the Heydrichs could also afford to employ 2 maids and a butler. Elisabeth ran the financial and administrative side of the family business, holding together what would otherwise have soon disintegrated had it been left in the hands of her artistically talented but financially inept husband, who spent money more quickly than he earned it. Bruno's musical talents and social skills, combined with his wife's fortune, secured the Heydrich family a respected place in the Halle community. They cultivated personal relationships with the mayor of Halle and the editor of the local newspaper, the Saale Zeitung. Another close family friend was Count Felix von Luckner, who would rise to fame during the Great War as one of Germany's most celebrated naval war heroes. Reinhard Heydrich was therefore born into a family of considerable financial means and social standing, a family that endeavored to lead an orderly life, characterized by regularity and hard work, as was typical for an upwardly mobile German bourgeois family at the turn of the century. While Heydrich's mother devoted herself entirely to the household and the children's well-being, occasionally working as a piano teacher in her husband's conservatory, his father Bruno primarily gloried in his profession as a director. The gender-specific distribution of roles in the Heydrich household was normal for the time. The father was the unchallenged head of the family and made all important decisions concerning child-rearing and education, while the mother, together with governesses in the case of the Heydrich family, looked after the children's everyday needs. Girls, including Reinhard's elder sister Maria, were prepared for their anticipated roles as mothers and wives, whereas boys were raised as future providers and heads of their own household. Only 4 months after Reinhard's birth, in the summer of 1904, the Heydrichs moved into a significantly larger home. The swell of new students and the resulting space shortage had forced Bruno Heydrich to look for new premises. In July 1904, Bruno Heydrich's Conservatory for Music and Theater moved from two separate buildings in Marienstrasse to Poststrasse, one of the more salubrious districts of Halle's city center. This neighborhood, with its grand-looking buildings, offered a perfect environment for the Heydrich family business, entirely focused on the educational and representational needs of the middle-class community. The new conservatory also provided a spacious home for the owner's family and offered a larger number of classrooms and musical instruments, as well as its own rehearsal stage. Young Reinhard clearly benefited from the musical talents of his parents. As the eldest son, he would one day inherit the conservatory, a professional destiny that required rigorous musical training from an early age. Even before starting primary school in 1910, he had learned musical notation. He could play Czerny's piano etudes perfectly and had begun violin lessons. His father encouraged his musical interests, and in 1910, at the age of only 6, Bruno and his son attended an exceptional musical highlight in the Halle City Theatre, a staging of The Ring of the Nibelung with the Bayreuth cast. The passion for romantic music, and for the mythical world of Wagnerian opera in particular, would remain with Reinhard for the rest of his life, a passion he shared with the future Führer of Nazi Germany, Adolf Hitler. The Heydrich family's daily life ran according to precisely determined and consistently maintained rules. Elisabeth Heydrich took both religious education and active participation in church life extremely seriously. Two conversions had turned the Heydrichs from the Protestant to the Catholic Church. On his marriage to the Catholic Maria Antonia Mauch, Reinhard's maternal grandfather, Eugen Kranz, had converted from Protestantism. In the subsequent generation, the Protestant Bruno Heydrich gave in to his wife's demands and converted to Catholicism. This was not an easy decision in an overwhelmingly Protestant society. Religion, always an important force in German life, had acquired a new and heightened significance since the foundation of the German Empire in 1871. The Kulturkampf, Bismarck's unsuccessful attempt to break political Catholicism during the late 1870s and early 1880s through the persecution and arrest of hundreds of Catholic priests for using the pulpit for political ends, left a bitter legacy of mutual suspicion between Protestants and Catholics. By the time of Heydrich's birth, however, the intensity of confessional antagonism was on the wane. At grassroots level, there was a tendency in popular Catholicism to move away from the insular culture of the 1870s towards an ostensibly patriotic attitude designed to counter the accusation that the main allegiance of German Catholics lay with Rome and not the Reich. Yet religion remained an important aspect of Heydrich's early life. While Protestant church attendance rates dropped significantly in the early 20th century, the secularization process was less dramatic for the Catholic Church, where observance was much more resilient. The Heydrichs were part of this resilient Catholic milieu. Elizabeth, a pious Catholic, led the children in their evening prayers, and on Sundays the whole family attended Mass. Reinhard served as an altar boy in the local Catholic Church. His consciously maintained Catholicism was one of the few oddities in his early life, particularly when measured against his radically anti-Catholic stance in the 1930s. It made him a member of a tiny minority in the overwhelmingly Protestant city of Halle. According to a census of 1905, 94% of Halle's 170,000 inhabitants were Protestants. The Catholic community, by contrast, had just over 7,000 members. Another oddity of his childhood, considering his obsession with bodily fitness in subsequent years, was his physical frailty. As a child of slender and relatively small stature, with a weak constitution and a susceptibility to illness, Reinhard was encouraged by his parents to take up every kind of physical exercise from an early age: swimming, running, football, sailing, horse riding, and fencing. Heydrich's lifelong passion for sport began here. The family's summer vacations were usually spent on the picturesque coast of the Baltic Sea, in the swanky seaside town of Swinemunde, on the island of Usedom. For the Heydrich children, this was surely the most exciting time of the year. They spent their holidays sightseeing, taking walks, and enjoying boat excursions and days on the beach. Meanwhile, the conservatory continued to flourish. By 1907, it counted a total of 250 fee-paying pupils, and the number of employees rose to 19. Just 1 year later, in 1908, the conservatory had 300 pupils, enough to prompt the Heydrichs to consider a further enlargement of their business. In April 1908, Reinhard had just turned 4, the Heydrichs moved again, this time into a much larger and grander purpose-built house in Gutschenstrasse, in which Reinhard was to spend most of his childhood and adolescence. The three-story house, in an exclusive, status-conscious location near the city theatre, testified to the increasing wealth of the family, generated by Elisabeth's income from the Dresden Conservatory and Bruno's ever-expanding Halle Conservatory, which, by 1911, reached a record high of 400 pupils and employed 27 permanent teachers. "The house," a school friend of Reinhard's remembered after the war, "gave the impression of prosperity. Grand, wood-paneled rooms, a lot of silver dishes, the finest porcelain." In the courtyard building, there was a large music chamber where regular soirees and concerts were given, and school friends celebrated Reinhard's birthday parties. A contemporary architecture critic conveyed just how large and well-appointed the Heydrich family home really was. "The conservatory is located in leafy surroundings in the spacious three-story wing of a splendid new building by Jentsch and Reichardt in Gutschenstrasse. The building houses a number of bright, friendly classrooms, nearly all of them looking out onto the green gardens, a waiting room, an administration office, and everything that makes up a modern school building. But the conservatory's main attraction is the splendid hall on the ground floor, which is seating for 300 people. Spacious, bright, and airy, it provides an extremely pleasant summertime abode to the many friends and sponsors who have been coming to the conservatory's performances for years in order to follow the progress of Heydrich's pupils. The hall, with its tasteful electrical lighting system and its ingeniously painted decorations, makes one imagine to be in one of those nice little private princely theatres that charm visitors in castles here and there." Given Bruno's economic success and social ambitions, it had always been clear that his eldest son would attend high school. Secondary schooling at the time was reserved for a small, privileged, and overwhelmingly male elite. In the early 1900s, some 90% of German pupils never went beyond primary school. Of the fortunate 10% attending all-boys secondary schools, some 66% continued their education in the humanist Gymnasien, which ended with the Abitur, the school leaving certificate qualifying them to attend university. The remaining 34% attended the Oberrealschule, a slightly less academic institution whose leaving certificate did not qualify its pupils for university. When the time came for Reinhard to go to secondary school, his parents decided to send him to the local Reform Gymnasium, a relatively new institution that embodied the scientific optimism of the dynamic, future-oriented German Empire. The Reform Gymnasium was designed to reconcile the characteristics of the classical gymnasium, with its emphasis on a rounded humanist education and training in Latin and ancient Greek, with the modern educational requirements of the early 20th century. As with the majority of the new polytechnical universities in the German Reich, the Reform Gymnasium had its origins in the technological zeal and enthusiasm of the late 19th century, which in turn helped to foster Germany's leading role in the so-called Second Industrial Revolution, based on technological innovation. By the time Heydrich started secondary school, Germany had become Europe's industrial powerhouse, internationally dominant in the fields of chemistry, physics, and engineering. Bruno Heydrich's decision to send his eldest son to a Reform Gymnasium was therefore not only the result of Reinhard's good grades, but also a tribute to the technological and scientific optimism of the era. The Reform Gymnasium was modern in yet another sense. While the vast majority of German schools at the time were denominational, the Reform Gymnasium was not affiliated to any religious persuasion. In 1906, no fewer than 95% of Protestant...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.